So I got this cassette tape way back in 1992 or so from my brother Rob, who was then studying film scoring and would go on to a career in commercial and film editing. Well, we were freaks for Star Trek in the 1970s, and he, no doubt, like many others, took inspiration from the music on this tape with Saul Kaplan's Doomsday Machine and Gerald Fried's Amok Time. Well, as far as original Trek goes, they just don't get much better than the thrilling Season 2 premiere. For Star Trek's 30th anniversary, TV Guide ranked Amok Time number 2 on its list of the 10 best Star Trek episodes. In 2016, The Hollywood Reporter rated Amok Time, get this, the 28th best television episode of all Star Trek franchise television prior to Discovery. I mean, there just aren't any holes in this episode. The casting, the directing, the acting, the script, set production, and cinematography are top-notch, as is Gerald Fried's original music. Well, as with Shore Leave, Gerald Fried again writes music for a Theodore Sturgeon script. And with Amok Time, Fried pushes the envelope well past conventional sounds and styles. It is also another example of the use of leitmotif, where a theme is composed specifically for a character or a place or an event. Because the storyline focuses specifically on Spock, Mr. Fried creates a theme that will forever follow Spock, his branding music, if you will. Again, employing tonal dissonances, the short lead-off cue, Mr. Spock, in the opening act begins with a cluster of woodwinds grouped in half-step intervals in an upward chromatic pattern.
Thank you, Captain. I suppose most of us overlook the fact that even Vulcans aren't indestructible.
It is then joined by solo electric bass guitar playing the Mr. Spock theme.
We're not.
Well, this cue expresses emotion and longing, but by scoring the melody for bass guitar, Fried chose an instrument that he felt was unable to express emotion or longing, thus establishing the internal conflict within Spock. The part was played in studio by jazz guitar great Barney Kessel, who did session work as part of LA's renowned Wrecking Crew. Now, the Spock theme is heard several times more in Amok Time, and was tracked often throughout Season 2. Though the bass guitar would be the primary instrument throughout the drama, one variation has it played on solo trombone after Captain Kirk is dead in the cue Remorse. Check this out.
Get your hands off of him, Spock. It's finished.
And before the Enterprise arrives at Vulcan, when Nurse Chapel goes to Spock's quarters, the Spock theme is played on cello and contrabass, and then a key change to violas in Fried's masterful cue, More Soup. Tracked again and again in Season 2, what could make a better killer cue?
If this record should survive me, I wish it known that I bequeath my highest commendation and testimonial to the captain, officers, and crew of the Enterprise. Finest starship in the fleet.
I don't understand.
Each day you stay alive is just one more day you might slip.
Being Vulcan is more important.
Let your human half peek out.
Then you stand there, speaking rules and regulations from Starfleet and Vulcan philosophy.
That's it, isn't it?
And let your father die.
And security.
And I'll hate you for the rest of my life.
Why, you wouldn't know what to do with a genuine, warm, other decent feeling.
We'll go to him. Now, please.
Would you make me some of that?
I cannot.
We'll make soup.
Oh, I'd be very glad to do that, Mr. Spock.
The other main leitmotif was composed for the events related to Spock's description of the Vulcan Pon Farr, ultimately rendered as the well-known and oft-quoted Star Trek fight music. Maybe more than any other Fried composition, this displays the hand of a master at work. Everything in this piece speaks of conflict, violence, tension, danger. But before Spock and Kirk square off in mortal combat, you and I have already heard this theme twice. Don't believe me? Well, a viewer left a comment that made me go back and check. One of my favorite Star Trek musical moments occurs in the brilliant episode Amok Time. Immediately after Spock says it is the Pon Farr, the time of mating, we hear a brooding melody played quietly. Later, the same melody is blasted out aggressively as Spock and Kirk fight to the death. Well, my viewer was right. The initial rendering of this theme is the cue, Pon Farr. It's that private discussion in Spock's quarters where he reveals to Captain Kirk the hidden truth about Vulcan mating practices. The piece is written in 5/4 time. The underlying pulse is a tritone interval in staccato eighth notes. Over this, muted trumpets and winds slowly and quietly play the theme. At this slow tempo, it's so subtle that it only subliminally foreshadows the coming violence.
We shield it with ritual and customs shrouded in antiquity. You humans have no conception. It strips our minds from us. It brings a madness which rips away our veneer of civilization. It is the Pon Farr, time of mating. There are precedents in nature, Captain. The giant eel birds of Regulus V, once each 11 years, they must return to the caverns where they hatched. On your Earth, the salmon, they must return to that one stream where they were born to spawn, or die in trying.
But you're not a fish, Mr. Spock, you're...
No. Nor am I a man. I'm a Vulcan. I'd hoped I would be spared this. But the ancient drives are too strong. Eventually, they catch up with us. We are driven by forces we cannot control to return home and take a wife.
Well, the second rendering takes place on Vulcan in the cue Processional. This time, everything is scored more boldly with more going on. The bass guitar makes a reappearance. The melody is more pronounced, and it introduces an antiphonal character, a call and response, with dissonant clashes in the horns responding to the winds.
Thank you.
You know who that is? Powell. The only person to ever turn down a seat in the Federation's Council.
Powell. Officiating at Spock's wedding.
He never mentioned that his family was this important.
Well, at last we come to the actual conflict. Remember, this was the season 2 premiere episode. What better way to win over your audience than to have your first officer kill his captain? Well, the piece opens with that dissonant clashing fanfare. It's the same tonal composition as the fake dummy cue from season 1, Shore Leave. Remember that? That D natural against an E, an A flat against the B flat, and then woodwinds. Only here it's revoiced with trumpets, trombones, and French horns. The time signature is again 5-4, but the tempo now is double time and driven by staccato eighth notes, ostinato on bassoon and trombone that's doubled by electric bass, played again by Barney Kessel. You bass players, here, try this. 2, 3, 4, 5. Well, in Bond's The Music of Star Trek, Profiles in Style, a reproduction of Mr. Fried's original handwritten sketch appears on page 21. Let's look at what's missing. There's no key signature. It's an atonal key marking. I wouldn't know what key to call this anyway. The dissonant combat fanfare, again, is antiphonal, with trumpets joining the woodwinds in the upper registers first, while the French horn, bassoon, and trombones respond in the lower registers. Listen to this. Now, following this, all the instruments join in a building crescendo measure that will climax, where instruments divide into a full, but again dissonant, harmonic payoff that's really cool. At the divisi, the second beat of the fifth measure, the trumpets stay paired with woodwinds, playing closed major triads of concert B, B flat, B, A. Remember, the trumpet is a B flat instrument, so this D flat major chord would sound a whole step lower, thus B major. This is predominantly what we hear because it's in the higher registers, and it's the same harmony as the winds, like this. But there's a secret ingredient that makes it both richer and crazier. I'm amazed at Fried's daring ingenuity. Your piano teacher would never let you try this. Sit down and play a B major chord with your right hand, and then play a C major chord with your left hand. Now, play them both at the same time. That's what's happening in the lower registers. In the measure before, their notes are identical to the winds and trumpets, only an octave lower. But when they divide into their closed triads, look what happens in the French horn. Focus on this, which is a transposing instrument. From the horn, you transpose up a perfect fourth to get to concert pitch, right? While the higher parts divide on a B major triad, you'll see in the horns, this is a G natural, B natural, and D natural. A G major chord for the horns, but when you transpose that up a fourth to concert pitch, friends, that's a C major chord below the trumpets with their B major chord. It's one semitone short of an octave. Listen. And it's reinforced in the trombones and bassoons. Talk about dissonance. Check them out together. Mm-hmm. that's what's going on harmonically. But taken as a whole, with the driving bass, the percussion, the woodwinds, the trumpets, and of course, what we're watching playing out on the TV screen, this is a crazy five chords that work perfectly to express the madness of the Vulcan Ponfar.
Now, wait a minute, ma'am. Who said anything about a fight to the death?
These men are friends. Force them to fight till one of them is killed.
I can forgive such a display only once. Challenge was given and lawfully accepted. It has begun. Let no one interfere.
When asked how he knew a composer could take chances with Star Trek, Fried responded that with show producer Bob Justman, you could tell. You'd suggest something and his face would brighten. And you get the subliminal vibes that this is the kind of show you could take chances on.